Good evening and welcome to our Good Friday service. You know, it's interesting calling tonight good. I actually just had this conversation with my oldest son. He said, why in the world do we call this Good Friday? I mean, why don't we call it Black Friday? And I said, you know, honestly, that's a really great question. When you think about what it is that we're remembering tonight, the total and utter rejection of God by humanity is what happened on this night. And yet at the same time, we call it good. And here's why we call it good is because in the middle of our sin, in the middle of our rebellion, in the middle of our rejection, what was God doing? God was using it for our good. God was using it to accomplish the good of purchasing our salvation. And so in many ways, tonight is a night of both sadness and joy. Right, on the one hand, tonight's a night of sadness because we are confronted on this night with the reality and the seriousness of our sin. The reality of it is this, Romans chapter 3, verse 23, all have sinned. There's no one who is guiltless. There is no one, not a single person on the planet who can say, yeah, I've got it all together in terms of my relationship with God. I don't have a sin problem. In fact, 1 John chapter 1 says, if we say that we have no sin, then the truth is not in us. And we've just deceived ourselves. Every single one of us has sinned. All of us have broken God's commandment, God's law. And all of us, as a result, Romans 6:23, are deserving of God's judgment, are deserving of God's wrath. And not only are we confronted with the reality that we've all sinned, but the seriousness of it. And the seriousness of it is this. We've sinned, we're deserving judgment, and there's nothing we can do to fix it. Right, most religions tell you that the way that you actually make yourself right with God is following the rules. If you can just follow the law, then you'll be okay with God. But the fact of the matter is this. God did not give his law as a ladder or as a stairway to get to him. The Bible says that God gave the law as a wall. That when we tried to use the law in order to make ourselves right with him, we're just hitting our heads against the wall and we're coming face to face with the hopelessness, our powerlessness to try to make ourselves right with him. See, the message, the reason that tonight is a good night, the reason tonight's a celebration in the middle of all that sadness is this, that God sent his son Jesus to do for us what we could not do for ourselves. In the face of all of our sin, in the face of our rejection of him, in the face of us deserving his judgment, in the face of knowing all of our sin. Psalm 139 verse 4 says that David writes it this way. He says, even before a word is on my tongue, God knows it altogether. In other words, listen, you don't ever surprise God with your sin. God knows all of your sin, past, present, and future. And yet, get this, God, knowing all of it, so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, that whoever would believe in him would not perish, but have everlasting life. And listen, God showed his love for us in this, that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Now listen, we can think of that in very general terms. We can think of our sin in a very general idea that I've got sin out there. But tonight, here's what I want to challenge you to do. Tonight, I want to challenge you to get specific. I want you to think in detail. Not of all of your sin, but here's what I want you to do. I want you to get a piece of paper. It can be a scrap piece of paper. It doesn't have to be anything special. And I want you to get a pen, pencil, whatever, a writing utensil. And I want you to write something on that paper for me right now. I want you to look at your life as all the things that are going on around our world. Part of, we said a few weeks back, that part of the reason that God allows us to go through hard things is to bring to the surface stuff in us that needs to get changed. And you've had a couple weeks now in the middle of this pandemic, and I'm guessing, like me, you've had stuff come to the surface. Maybe things that you don't like seeing about yourself. Maybe attitudes, maybe reactions, maybe words that have come out that you see in your life and you're like, oh, that, I don't like that. That hurts. I want you to look at your life right now. And on that piece of paper, and by the way, this piece of paper is just between you and God. I'm not going to have you show it to anyone. No one else should be looking at it. It's just for you and God. And I want you to write down that one sin in your life that you look at and you go, and listen, I know there's more than one sin in everybody's life, but I want you to just write down that one that you look at that you tend to struggle with the most. Maybe it's the sin that man, you're afraid that anybody else would find out about that sin. I want you to write it down on that paper and just hold on to it. We're going to talk about it later in the evening, but I want you to hold on to that as we go through this night, as we reflect on Jesus and what he's done for us on the cross. For right now, here's what we're gonna do. We're gonna sing, we're gonna reflect, we're gonna worship. And during this time, you know, if you need to go grab that pen, that pencil, that piece of paper, grab it and spend that time reflecting as we sing and write that down. Hold on to that paper, we'll come back to it later. Let's worship together.
Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. So here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. King of all days, so highly exalted, glorious in heaven above. Humbly you came to the earth you created, all for love's sake became poor. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. And I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. And I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. And I'll never know how much it cost to see altogether wonderful to me. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only son to make a wretch his treasure. How great which mar the chosen one, bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon a cross, my sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed, I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there until it was a His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. I will not boast in anything, no gifts, no power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer. I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know. But this I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom.
Tonight, as we reflect on the cross, I want us to focus on one particular part of the story and one particular person. A person that we tend to not really talk about very much. We kind of skim right past him. We don't really think about this part of the story as much as I think we should, because it's a pretty important moment. It's not accidental. It's not an interruption. It's actually the whole story of the cross contained in this one moment. The whole story of the cross for you contained in this moment. It's in Matthew chapter 27 and starting verse 15. But before we get there, let me give you a little bit of the context. The context is that Jesus has been betrayed by a kiss from one of his followers, Judas. His disciples, he was arrested. His disciples run in the other direction. They're scared. Jesus is led to a place where he's given the mockery of a trial. False witnesses are called. They speak out against him. He ends up being beaten and spit on. In the process, another one of his disciples, Peter, denies him three times and runs in guilt and shame after he's finished his last denial. And then he's led to the governor, to Pilate. And while he's there, this is what happens. Listen, this is starting in verse 15. Now at the feast, the governor was accustomed to release for the crowd any one prisoner whom they wanted. And they had then a notorious prisoner called Barabbas. So when they had gathered, Pilate said to them, "Who do you want me to release for you, Barabbas or Jesus, who is called Christ?" For he knew that it was out of envy that they had delivered him up. Besides, while he was sitting on the judgment seat, his wife sent word to him, "Have nothing to do with that righteous man, for I have suffered much because of him today in a dream." Now the chief priests and the elders persuaded the crowd to ask for Barabbas and destroy Jesus. The governor said to them, which of the two do you want me to release to you? And they said, "Barabbas." Pilate said to them, "Then what shall I do with Jesus, who is called the Christ?" They all said, "Let him be crucified." And he said, "Why? What evil has he done?" And they shouted all the more, "Let him be crucified." Now, the person we're going to focus on tonight is this man, Barabbas. Again, someone that we don't tend to think of very, very much. Someone that maybe, you know, we pass over that story as being a bit of an interruption in the process of Jesus heading to the cross. But again, it's not an interruption. It's not an accident. There's something very intentional that God is doing here in this moment. Right, but you've got this criminal, Barabbas, he's called notorious. And notorious means he's a really good, well-known criminal. He's good at breaking the law. And then you've got Jesus, who's broken no laws. He's perfect. He's sinless. He's committed no crimes. There's no guilt in his life. There's nothing that they can accuse him of and have any evidence that he's done anything that's wrong. And on this night, Pilate knows that he gets the opportunity to release one person, and the crowd has the choice. And he brings these two out and stands them next to each other. He has Barabbas, well-known criminal, guilty. He's been tried. He's been condemned. He's going to be crucified, and he deserves it because of everything that he's done. And on the other side, he's got Jesus. Right, Jesus is the one who's ministered to the poor. He's healed the sick. He's raised the dead. He's cast out demons. He's spoken about love and care and compassion. He's been full of grace. And he asks the people, "Who do you want? Do you want Barabbas to go free, or do you want Jesus to go free?" And for a moment, I just want you to imagine for yourself to be Barabbas in this moment. If you're Barabbas in this moment, what do you assume? Who in your mind are they going to pick? Whose name do you expect to hear when they say, "Who do you want us to release?" You don't expect to hear your name because you know who you are. You may not know much about this Jesus, but you know your crimes. You know that you're guilty and you know what you deserve. And yet he's standing there in that moment. And the name that he hears is not Jesus. The name that the crowd calls out is Barabbas. And it's not because they care about Barabbas. In that moment, the reason they're calling out Barabbas is out of hatred for Jesus. The chief priests have convinced the crowd to call for Barabbas because they hate Jesus. But I want you to get this. In that moment, the people who are, the Barabbas' name isn't just being called by the crowds. In that moment, the name Barabbas is actually being called by God. Again, this is no accident. This is no mistake. This is no interruption in the story. This moment is God painting the picture of what the whole story is all about. What's the story about? The story is that God sent Jesus into this world for criminals. God sent Jesus into this world for lawbreakers. God sent Jesus into this world for people who deserve punishment. All of those who have sinned and fallen short of God's glory, who for whom the wages of sin is death. God sent Jesus into the world for those people to do what? To take their place. You see, in this moment, what's happening is that a criminal who deserves judgment and wrath instead is being set free, and the one who deserves to be set free is the one who's going to experience judgment. And see, that's what the gospel is all about. That's what Jesus Christ came to do. He came to take our place. A few moments ago, I asked you to take a piece of paper and to write down that one sin that you wrestle with most, that you struggle with the most. I want you to just take that paper out and I want you to look at that sin. And here's what I want you to think about. The Bible says that if we keep the whole law and yet we break it in one place, we're guilty of the whole thing. Which sounds a bit strange to us. Because in our minds, we think of the law as all of these separate pieces. I've got one law over here, I've got one law over there, and if I break that law, it has nothing to do with any of the other laws. And yet, the truth is, no, they're all interconnected. In fact, the way that you ought to think of it is to think of it like a plate. If you crack a plate, it's not just a crack, it's a cracked plate, because the plate is one whole piece, and now you've cracked the whole thing. And see, that's the way the law is. Because the law, yes, it's all these individual laws, and yet it's one whole piece. Why? Because the entirety of the law can be summarized in one way. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength, and love your neighbor as you love yourself. Those two things go together. You can summarize the entirety of the law as love. And the reality is this: every single one of us, we've cracked the plate. Every single one of us has failed. We said it already. All have sinned. All are deserving of judgment. All are deserving of wrath. And yet, here's what God has done for you tonight. Imagine it. Imagine standing in the place of Barabbas, but not before a crowd. Imagine standing before God. You're standing next to Jesus, the person who sinned, the person who has that thing written down on that piece of paper. And in this moment, here's what you know you deserve. If you were standing before God, it would be clear. You would know exactly what you deserve. Standing next to Jesus, who is perfectly sinless and righteous, you would know that you're the one who deserves judgment. And yet, here's what happened on that night. God called your name. God chose you to go free and sent his son to take your place and to go to the cross so that you might be set free. Would you think about that as we watch this video?
Which prisoner do you want me to pardon? Barabbas! Or Jesus, the so-called Christ? What should I do with Jesus?
Crucify him!
Nail him to a tree!
What has he done wrong?
They're crucifying him.
Barabbas, they're crucifying the man that took your place. I don't mean your place. I'm not saying you should be crucified.
Our cells are next to each other.
The crowd is picking up. We need to go.
There was a hole in the wall between the cells. I could pull a piece out and see him. I saw everything.
Barabbas, the Romans may have let you go, but they aren't going to let you live.
They beat him. They cursed him. They spit on him.
He never said a thing.
He never fought back.
Once we get out of town and find someone to treat your wound.
Did you see what they did to him? His back. That crown. Those thorns.
At least it wasn't you.
Why not? Why not me? I am.
I don't know why not. But if we're going to leave, we need to leave now.
Stop! Stop talking! Just...
A few hundred years before Jesus would have come to this earth, before he would have gone to the cross, the prophet Isaiah told us exactly what it was that he was going to do for us. And I want to read it to you right now. This is Isaiah chapter 53, and I'm going to start in verse 2. It says, "For he grew up before him like a young plant and like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, and no beauty that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and as one from whom men hide their faces. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgression. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the punishment, that the chastisement that brought us peace. And with his wounds we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all." The message of the cross is that he took our place. He took your place. He did it for you. And see, that's what we're celebrating when we come to communion, which we're going to celebrate in these next few moments. And I encourage you, get the elements, get the bread, get some juice. They're important elements because of what they represent. On the one hand, the bread represents the body of Christ having been broken for you. On the other hand, the cup represents the blood of Christ having been poured out for you. Two elements representing two sides of the amazing news of what Jesus has done for us. On the one hand, the news of his mercy, that he didn't give us what we deserved because he took it on himself. His body was broken for us. And on the other hand, the cup representing his grace, that not only did he not give us what we deserved, but he gave us the good that we did not deserve. He's given us forgiveness. He's given us salvation. He's given us an eternal relationship with God. It's been purchased as a gift for us. And listen, we want everybody to be able to celebrate this with us tonight, but there are two requirements for you to be able to celebrate this. The first requirement is that you're a part of the family. This is a family meal. And the only way that you get to be a part of the family is if you've believed and trusted in Jesus Christ as your Savior. To all who believed in his name, he gave the right to be called children of God. The first question you've got to ask yourself is, have I actually believed? Yes, Jesus died. He paid the penalty for sin. But the only way that that payment gets applied to your life is if you trust Jesus has actually done that for you. Have you believed? And if you haven't, that's the first invitation of Good Friday, is to come face to face with the reality of your sin, but to know that God has called your name and he's inviting you into a relationship with him on the basis of what he's done for you through Jesus Christ. The second requirement is that we examine ourselves. You know, we wrote that sin on that paper for a reason. And in these next few moments, here's what we're going to do. Our worship pastor is going to lead us, and we're going to have time to reflect. And what I want to challenge you to do is I want you to take that paper out, and I want you to talk to God about what's on there. And here's what we do. We confess in the context of faith in what Jesus Christ has done for us. And here's what we do when we confess, is we own our sin for what it is. No excuses, no blame shifting, no minimizing. That in this moment, as we get ready to celebrate this meal together, we own up and we confess it to God. So I encourage you to do some, just look into your heart in these next few moments as we sing, to examine your life. Have you believed? And have you dealt with that sin that's in your life? Let's prepare to celebrate communion together.
Alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe. This gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on that cross, as Jesus died,
To celebrate communion in these next few moments, but before we do, I'm going to read the story of the crucifixion. And as we do, I want to ask you to do something a little bit different. Instead of just sitting and listening, I want you to take that piece of paper back out, and here's what I want you to do with it. As I'm reading, is I want you to crumple that piece of paper up, and I want you to walk over to the trash can, wherever the closest trash can in your house. You can turn, again, you turn up the volume so you can keep listening as we read through the story of the crucifixion. I want you to take that trash, that garbage, and I want you to put it in the trash can. Because here's the reality, that if we have confessed our sins, if you confessed your sins, 1 John chapter 1 says this, if we've confessed our sins, that he is faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we confess it, if we say what God says about it, if we call it sin, no blame shifting, right? Complete, we own it. We don't minimize it. When we confess our sins, he's faithful. That means he does it all the time. If you confess your sins, God doesn't forgive sometimes and then later on go, nah, you know what? It's been too many times. God is faithful to always forgive. And not only is he faithful to do it, he's just to do it. And the reason that he is just to forgive your sins is because God is not just saying, hey, let's pretend like that didn't happen. When God forgives your sins, he forgives because he's already dealt with it on the cross. So as I read, I want you to take that piece of paper and I want you to crumple it up and I want you to get rid of it. Do that as I read. So they took Jesus. And he went out bearing his own cross to the place called the place of the skull, which in Aramaic is called Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with him two others, one on either side, and Jesus between them. Pilate also wrote an inscription and put it on the cross. It read, Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews. Many of the Jews read this inscription, for the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city. And it was written in Aramaic, in Latin, and in Greek. So the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate, do not write the King of the Jews, but rather this man said, I am the King of the Jews. Pilate answered, what I have written, I have written. After this, Jesus, knowing that all was now finished, said to fulfill the scripture, I thirst. A jar full of sour wine stood there. So they put a sponge full of sour wine on a hyssop branch and held it to his mouth. When Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, it is finished. And he bowed his head and he gave up his spirit. I want you to hear those words and I want you to hear them in the context of that sin that you just threw in the trash. It is finished. It means it's done. It's been paid in full. It's been paid once for all time. It never has to be paid for again. You don't have to pay for your sin. You don't. In fact, the truth is you could never have paid for your sin. But Jesus Christ, he's done it for you. It's finished. Let's celebrate communion together. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took the bread and he broke it, giving thanks. And he says, this is my body broken for you. Do this as often as you eat it in remembrance of me. In the same way, he took the cup, giving thanks. He says, this is the cup of the new covenant, sealed and purchased for you with my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Paul writes, for as often as we eat this bread and we drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. And he is coming again. Amen. And by the way, the reason that we know that is because, listen, the cross is not the end of the story, right? There's more to the story, and we're going to celebrate that on Easter morning in just 2 days. But here's the deal. We've got a lot to celebrate tonight. We've got a lot to be thankful for. And so what we're going to do in these next few moments, we're just going to close by singing in worship one more song. Let's celebrate and worship our God, our good God and Savior, together.
I hear the Savior say, thy strength indeed is small. Shall the weakness watch and pray, find in me thine all in all. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Lord, now indeed I find
are so glad that you could come and celebrate with us tonight. But I want you to know the celebration isn't over. In fact, if you stop here, the story is incomplete. The rest of the celebration happens on Sunday morning as we get to celebrate the resurrection. So I want to invite you to come back out. Our service goes live at 10 a.m. You can find that information on our Facebook page. If you're interested, we'd love to have you join us. But for now, as we go, now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than we can ask, imagine, or think because of his power at work within us. Him be glory in the church in Christ Jesus and in all generations now and forevermore. And all of God's people say, amen. And God bless you.